So, today we will discuss another kind of issue and a problem with assessment and evaluation. And here we will see what are the issue and problem with marking versus grading, objectivity versus subjectivity, open-ended test item versus closed-ended test item, and the relative neglect of non-cognitive aspect. So these things we will discuss in this class, that what are the issue, what are the problem with this aspect in assessment and evaluation. And here the discussion will be not very much new, but we will try to see these things from the different perspective, because all those things in some or other way we have discussed already in other classes. So that the different perspective of these things we will try to see. The first thing is that marking versus grading. That when we do the assessment and evaluation, generally, usually, we use to assign the mark, and the mark is reflecting the performance of the child. So we are assessing the students, their performance, their learning achievement in terms of the mark related to the learning outcome. And here we used to see that to which extent the learner has progressed in terms of mark. For sake of example, when we are assessing, suppose that the knowledge and understanding subdomain under the cognitive domain as per the Bloom taxonomy, and we are giving a question of 100 mark questions we have given. So we try to see that out of 100 mark, how much the child is able to secure. And on the basis of that numerical mark, we are trying to assess the performance. However, there is a serious problem with this. It looks like that here we are only assigning the some numerical value for their performance. But when we see this assessment method, actually it leads to unnecessary throat cut competition among the learner. Unnecessary. Because when we talk about that some student have secured 80 mark and some student have secured 81 mark or 82 mark or 83 mark, or below that even we can see that 79 mark or 78 mark, there is no much difference in the performance of these two children. Because the mark that they are securing, that is variable on so many of the things. It may be that the child is not able to organize their thought, their understanding in a writing during the examination. So that slightly more or slightly less mark is coming. Or it may be also possible that due to the subjective nature of some question, some test item that is asked, and that's why examiner, those who are evaluating the answer script, they have given some more marks slightly or some less mark. Because when we talk about the subjective items, we know that there is a possibility that same or a similar kind of a response can get a slightly higher or a slightly lower mark. For sake of example, if the question is of a 10 mark and the two answer given by two student is similar, then someone will get, suppose that 8 mark, someone may get 7 mark, someone may get 9 mark also. So because of the nature of the test item, it is quite possible. It is also quite possible that the student is not able to perform better, slightly better or the slightly less because of the other variables. Some student find it difficult in sitting in 3 hours of exam. Some student may have an exam anxiety, that's why they have performed slightly less. Okay, so all those things are actually not a very distinct from each other. They are not actually distinct, but it looks little bit different in terms of a mark when we see, and which creates an unnecessary throat-cut competition, which leads to the stress and anxiety, development of stress and anxiety. Even it leads to unnecessary competition, which again propagates into the unusual behavior in the child's day-to-day life. Because they are trying to fetch each and every mark, which is actually not a different. It also create problem with the parents, because parents, they used to judge their parenting with the marks secured by the children. It happens in the society, in the house. They used to judge their parenting, they used to judge their nurturing of the child, their education, and by it is projected on their own performance. So they force unnecessarily to the child. Even when we talk about in the more general and more specific event also, that these marks are used to explain the excellency of the educational institute, schools, that how their school is excellent. Their students are able to secure more and more marks. And even the efficiency of the teacher also, which again leads to the scope of malpractice in the exam. Sometimes the student try to do the malpractices, and sometimes even it is supported by the teacher, school and a parent. We used to see a lot of news in the newspaper, in the other news media during the board examination. 10th and 12th board examinations are being conducted throughout the country. We used to find several things, which is actually not at all worthy to discuss all those things. So, in contrast with this, the CBSE, even the NCERT has proposed, which is adopted by the CBSE and the other state board, that instead of providing the numbers, actual number, it may be further converted into the grade. Then the grade may be either the numerical grade or the alphabetical grade, like the A, B, C, D, or A plus, or A2, A1, B2, B1, like that. It may be the numerical grade or the alphabetical grade, that is the E material to discuss here. But it is proposed that to reduce this unnecessary competition, unnecessary the way of imposing stress and anxiety on the part of a student, we can have a grading system where in a range of mark will be clubbed in one grade, like that 90 to 100 will be one grade, you can term it as A, then 80 to 90, then again it will be another grade B, or if you want to assign the numeric grade, it may be 1, 2, like that. So, the point of saying that if we are converting the actual score of a student into a grade, it will reduce some unnecessary competition, which is giving a very bad impact on the part of a society, even the children, even the school, even the management of the school. And that's why the NCERT and CBSE has proposed the grading system, and it is of the 9th grade. Here the important thing is that how we can reduce the stress and anxiety, competition and all those things which are not at all worthy, which is not at all significant. Because if someone is getting 80 and someone is getting 81, then it is not at all significant. Okay, there is no significant difference. Okay, so that's why the grading system was introduced by the all, even in the country when we talk now, it is introduced by all boards. Okay, and it was proposed by the NCERT after so much of research and after seeing the international perspective, what is happening in and around the world. So that was the one of the important issue when we talk about the assessment and evaluation. Because assessment, when you will see the assessment and evaluation position paper of NCF 2005, it also says that examination is a matter of stress and anxiety, and student must be saved, student must be given a comfortable zone to reduce stress and anxiety. And that's why the several examination reform is proposed by NCERT. Examination reform is the position paper of NCF 2005. Published by the NCERT. You can see in the NCERT website, examination reform. There are other steps also like that, the restructuring the question paper, providing extra time for understanding and reading the questions, and restructuring the type of a question. All those things are there. In that, this is the also one of the important initiative taken by the NCERT and implemented by the school education boards. Then next thing is that the problem of objectivity and subjectivity. So when we see the type of a question that is being asked in the examination, you will see some questions are matching type, some questions are true and false. In some questions you have to pick the appropriate right answer, that is a MCQ type. In some question you have to fill the blank. Some questions are very short answer type, like one liners. Some questions are short answer type, where you have to explain the asked thing very briefly. And some questions are long answer time, where in you have to explain, interpret, analyze and synthesize in order to respond the questions. So when you will see this type of a question, you will find that the earlier question that I have told, like a matching type of a question, MCQ type of a question, fill in the blank type of a question, these type of a question, when you will find these type of a questions are objectified question, objectives questions. The point of saying is that in these questions, if you will respond correctly, you will get a full mark. Like that, if a true or false type of a question is there, and if you have responded correctly, then full mark is one. So one mark you will get. If you have not responded correctly, then you will get a zero mark. So here the subjectivity of a examiner does not comes in between. Even way of expression of the question, way of explaining the fact, way of interpreting and presenting the answer doesn't matter, because There is one single answer of the question, and if you have responded correctly, you will get a full mark. Otherwise, you will get the zero mark. So this is the feature of this. But when you will see the long answer type of a question, open-ended type of a questions, in those type of a questions, you have to understand the concept. Suppose that whatever the question is asked and what is to which concept the question is related, you have to understand the question, and then you have to explain, analyze, synthesize and present your answer by citing, by quoting some relevant examples in your own way. So here what happens when I say that you have to organize, you have to understand and organize the answer, and you have to present the answer in your own way. So the way of a presentation matters. In the earlier one, the way of presentation doesn't matters, because there is a single answer, and if you have chosen the correct response, then you will get full mark. And if you have not chosen the correct one, then you will get a zero mark. But here when we talk about the open-ended question, here you have an opportunity to present your answer in your own way by citing your own examples, by explaining in your own way. Here the question becomes subjective, because everyone's way of presentation is a different. It may be different. Or if there is a different aspect of a single concept, you may be inclined towards some one aspect, wherein the other student who will... So I was saying here, you may be inclined towards one aspect of answer, some other student may be inclined towards the another aspect of answer. Okay, another aspect of that concept. And when the evaluator will evaluate, examiner will evaluate your answer, it will be as per their perception, as per their mood, as per their thought process of conceiving that concept, that what their thought process says, isn't it? So here the answer becomes a subjective in nature. Subjectivity comes on the part of an examiner also, and the subjectivity comes on the part of a student also. Because here the way of expressing, the way of writing is differing, is varying. That's why when we talk about the subjective type of a question, it is possible that the same or a similar type of a answer may get slightly higher or slightly lower mark depending upon the way it is presented, depending upon the thought process of the teacher, those who are evaluating, and depending upon the mental status of the teacher. Even it depends on the mental status of a student also. You may be knowing the thing very well, but because of something, you are unable to explain the thing the right manner. And earlier, when I remember my own time when I was writing board examination, the questions were coming subjective. Like that, when you have appeared for your this is the first year for you, you may see the previous year question of the B.Ed., our department B.Ed. Annual examination, you will find that there is a only long answer type of a question. There is a no objective question. There is a no short answer type of a question. and that was also happening in the board examinations. So some student was able to get a very good mark, whereas the some student were not able to get a good mark because the subjective nature of the questions. And that's why as a examination reform, it was suggested that there must be a variety of a question in the question papers when the board examination is coming. So all student must be able to secure some mark as per their ability. Otherwise, if it will be a only subjective type of question, then it will be difficult for some student, those who are not very good in explaining and expressing the things in the open-ended questions. So that was the another aspect of this subjectivity and objectivity in the assessment and evaluation. Then another thing which is in the syllabus is closed-ended and open-ended test item. I think while discussing the objectivity and subjectivity, I have explained this thing also. The type of a question which have one and unique answer, one liner. You are supposed to choose like that the fill in the blank, like that multiple choice type of a test item, or true and false. This type of a questions, or even the very short answer type of a question, because in the very short answer type of a question, you have to write the answer in a finite way. Your own creativity, your own way of writing, your own way of explaining will not come here. Even sometime the short answer type of a question, objective type of a question like that fill in the blank MCQ will always come as a closed-ended. Very short answer type of a question will also come under the closed-ended. Even the short answer type of a question also come under the closed-ended. The open-ended here means that where you have an opportunity to understand the concept and explain the concept as per your freedom. Choose your examples, mix the examples, and then explain the concept in your own way. That is the open-ended question. Here, that's why the issue and concern is the same and similar to the objectivity and the subjectivity. However, point of discussion is from the different angle. When we talk about the objectivity and subjectivity, the point of discussion is that from the student perspective and from the examiner's perspective. When we talk about the closed-ended and open-ended type of a test item, the point of discussion is from the type of a test items. Okay. Here, one more thing I will like to add, that when we talk about the open-ended question, I told that in open-ended question, you have opportunity to understand and explain the concept in your own way by citing examples, by organizing the answer in your own way. That opportunity you have. So your creativity and a critical thinking reflects here, because the way you are organizing the answer and the way I am organizing the answer, it may be different. And it will depend upon your skill, your critical thinking ability, creative thinking ability. It will depend. So the question comes, so many students used to ask the question, sir, in the mathematics, can the question be open-ended? In mathematics may be there, may be a different type of a question. One type of a question is like that, the short answer type of a question, or a fill in the blank, or a matching type, or a true or false. This type of a question may also be there. There are long answer type of a question is also there in the mathematics, wherein you have to prove any theorem, you have to derive any theorem, or you have to solve any mathematical problem like that. There is a student used to ask that whether is it possible to have an open-ended question in mathematics. Then I say yes, why not? There is a possibility of open-ended question in mathematics. Then they say, sir, we have a question problem, whether it is a problem or whether you have to derive a theorem, whatever it is. And then the answer is finite, because the way it is proved, the way it is solved, the same way we have to solve. So how it will be the open-ended? Because in the open-ended, my thought should come, my creative thinking should come, my way of organizing the answer should come. Then it's also correct. Then how it will be possible in mathematics? See, when we talk about the mathematics, mathematics is blessed with the creativity inbuilt. A single question can be solved in a multiple way. You can organize the writing of an answer in your own way. So, when you are getting opportunity to solve the answer in your own way, out of the multiple ways of solving a problem. One problem, mathematical problem, can be solved in a variety of ways, not only in one or two ways. It can be solved in a variety of ways. And out of those variety, you are choosing most appropriate method of solving problem or deriving a theorem. Most appropriate, which will consume less time, which will give more appropriate answer, where minimum mathematical calculation will be involved, and which can be done in short. Because in the examination, you have a limited time, and within the limited time, you have to respond all the test item that is presented in front of you. So, you have to keep all those things in your mind when you are framing the question to answer in the mathematics. Like that in the other field also, language, social science, science. Before writing, you are framing the answer. In mathematics also, we used to frame the answer before responding. And if this opportunity is there in mathematics, we can say that, yes, why not, the open-ended question is possible in mathematics. Yes, it is quite possible. Isn't it? So, that you must be very clear, because this is the type of a question maximum student used to ask, that how the open-ended question is possible in mathematics. So don't think that it is possible, the open-ended question in the mathematics too. Then the next point of discussion is the neglect of non-cognitive aspect in assessment and evaluation. Non-cognitive aspect means the aspect which is related to the skill, which is related to the affective domain of the learning, which is related to the health and the physical fitness of the child, which is important for the mental fitness of the child, which is related to the development of the social and emotional skill in the child. Variety of domains are there. Variety of sectors are there that needs to be assessed. And what happens in the school nowadays, when we have introduced CCE, continuous and comprehensive evaluation in the school. These aspects are being taken care of. But earlier, there was no such incident. In the name of assessment and evaluation, only the cognitive domain was being assessed. And the non-cognitive domain was being neglected. And it was neglected to the extent that no one was taking care that the way they are assessing, whether it is harming the child socially, emotionally, cognitively, what is the impact on their child, whether their own interest in the some area is suppressed. Suppose that I am very much interested in the game and sport or the cultural activity or in the literary activity or anything. But since the assessment and evaluation is only focused on the cognitive domain, so I have to work for that thing only. I have to remember, I have to memorize, and it was leading towards the rote learning. The number is immaterial. The student may be able to secure, they may be able to fetch the very good mark. That is the immaterial. That may be possible. They may be getting the very good mark. But the thing that they were not understanding the concept, and it was leading towards the rote learning, wherein the student are forcefully, they have to remember, memorize, and they have to write in the examination. So this all thing was seen, that was evaluated very meticulously, and it was decided that learning is not a process which will only happen in the class, which will only include the cognitive part. Because when we talk about the Bloom taxonomy and its a revision by the Anderson, the taxonomy of learning is existing since a long time. And the researchers say that the together with the cognitive domain, the affective domain, psychomotor domain needs to be developed. And sometimes they are much more important in order to spend a successful life in the society. If you have a very much knowledge, means cognitive part I am talking. But if you don't have a skill to use it, if you don't have a social skill to live in the society, if you don't have an emotional skill to manage your life, if you don't have a feeling towards the other, then that type of education is actually, in fact, it is a very dangerous education. Because the knowledge that can be used for the betterment of the society can also be used for the bringing negative impact in the society. So that's why it was proposed that both should be equally emphasized. Not both, all should be equally emphasized. All the aspect of a learning must be equally emphasized. And the non-cognitive part of the learning must be emphasized, and that must be assessed and evaluated, and that must also get part in the report card of the child progress, so that we will be able to understand the holistic development of the child, overall outlook of the child. What is the overall outlook? Hasn't it?